Hello friends, today we are going to discuss a very important topic, snake bite, its types and management. I have chosen this topic because there are many myths, even now, especially in rural areas, and the patient take local remedies, cut the bite wounds and put some local applications on the wound which are actually harmful for the patient. The management of snake bite is an emergency and each and every doctor should know its management. Let's begin. First of all, we will see what is the magnitude of this problem. What are the various types of venomous snakes of India and the type of venom they release? What are the clinical features of different types of snake bites? Then we will define the severity of the bite. And finally, we will discuss the management, which is initial management at their local place. After hospitalization, the investigation which we have to perform, the anti-venom treatment, which is the mainstay of treatment, and the supportive treatment. When we talk about this problem, the WHO has defined it is among top 20 neglected tropical diseases. The total cases worldwide are 4.2 to 18.4 lakhs annually, out of which the annual deaths are 1.25 lakhs. Therefore, this is very deadly disease if not treated. India has the highest number of deaths worldwide. Out of 1.25 lakhs annually, the deaths in India is almost 46,000, and this number is also underestimated because of the lack of proper registration of snake bite cases. Most cases are seen in UP, followed by Andhra Pradesh, followed by Bihar. Who are at risk people? The people who work outdoors, like farmers, laborers, fishermen, who live in open habitation, have open defecation and who sleep on floor. These are all at risk. Males are obviously more commonly bitten by snakes because they often work in fields and outdoors. Most common age group is 20 to 40 years, followed by 40 to 60 years. Now let's have a look at the venomous snakes found in India. There are three family of venomous snakes, that is Elapidae, Viperidae and Hydrophidae. The snakes included in Elapidae is common cobra or spectacled cobra. Its scientific name is Naja Naja. Other snake in Elapidae is common crate. Its scientific name is Bungarius ceruleus. The Viperidae, as the name suggests, have all the vipers, like Russell's viper, also known as Daboia russelli, saw-scaled viper known as Acis carinatus, and humped nose viper, that is Hypnale hypnale. The family Hydrophidae, hydro means living in water, includes sea snakes. Now discussing about the toxins these release. The toxin released by Elapidae is neurotoxin, that is cobra and crate release neurotoxin. The toxin released by viper, V for viper, V for vasculotoxin, is vasculotoxin or hemotoxin, that is same. And the toxin released by Hydrophidae, that is sea snakes, is myotoxin. Let's identify the different types of snakes. The first one in the picture, which we have commonly seen in our childhood, is common cobra, also known as spectacled cobra. This releases neurotoxin. The second one in this image, with black and white stripes, white stripes with black body is common crate. This also releases neurotoxin. The third one in the picture is Russell's viper. We will later see in the presentation that Russell viper secretes many types of a cocktail of toxins, which include hemotoxin, neurotoxin, as well as renal toxin. The last one is saw-scaled viper. The difference in Russell's viper and saw-scaled viper is the scales are saw-scaled, saw-shaped, and in this there are large circular scales. Now, when any person acquires a snake bite, it can be a non-poisonous bite or a poisonous bite. The good thing is that almost 85% of all snake bites are non-poisonous and only 15% of bites are poisonous. Non-poisonous bite can be by a non-venomous snake, that the snake does not produce venom, or it can be a dry bite by a venomous snake. What is a dry bite? When a venomous snake just bite and do not release any venom. The snakes most oftenly do this to preserve their venom for any future more dangerous fight. The 50% of bites by Russell viper are dry bite, 30% by common cobra are dry bite, and 10% are of saw-scaled viper are dry bites. In poisonous bite, it is a wet bite by a venomous snake. Now here is a concept. A venomous snake can be identified by small head scales and large body scales. On the other hand, it is vice versa for non-venomous scales. Snakes, that is large head scales and small body scales. Now let's see what are the clinical features of snake bite. These can be the features of local envenoming, systemic envenoming, and we will see features of severe envenomation. In local envenoming, there will be features at the site of bite. Systemic features can be cardiovascular, bleeding and clotting disorder, neurological, renal or endocrine. In local envenoming, we can find the fang marks of snake bite. That is, there will be two punctured marks at the site of bite. There can be local pain, which can be burning in quality, bursting or throbbing in nature. There can be local swelling, which can extend up to the limb. There can be enlarged and tender lymph nodes draining the site of bite, blistering, necrosis, as well as local bleeding. It is important to note that crate bites are typically painless and do not cause any local symptoms or local envenoming. Coming to systemic features, the early features include nausea, vomiting, abdominal pain, and weakness. These are usually seen with crate bite, and it can be very easily confused with any acute abdomen-like pathology. The cardiovascular features include dizziness, faintness, collapse, shock, hypotension, cardiac arrhythmias, and pulmonary edema. The cardiac arrhythmias can also be caused by sea snakes, which is due to rhabdomyolysis and hyperkalemia. In general, cardiovascular features are more common with vipers. Third are bleeding and clotting disorders. These are again common with wipers. This can be bleeding or thrombotic strokes. Bleeding can be either traumatic bleeding from any recent wounds or spontaneous bleeding like petechiae, purpura, epistaxis, conjunctival hemorrhage or intracranial hemorrhages. Thrombotic strokes are especially seen with Russell wiper bite. Coming to neurological features, these are common with cobra and crate bite, since these produce neurotoxin. There is a descending neuromuscular paralysis starting with bilateral ptosis, then external ophthalmoplegia and diplopia, facial muscle weakness, then bulbar and neck muscle weakness, and finally leading to respiratory or diaphragmatic paralysis. This is the stage where the patient needs mechanical ventilation. An ET tube should be inserted as soon as the neck muscles weakness start. The order of recovery is reverse, that is, ptosis is last to resolve. The renal system involvement is mainly by Russell wiper and hump-nosed wiper. This can include loin pain, hematuria, hemoglobinuria, myoglobinuria, or acute kidney injury. Endocrine system is usually involved by Russell wiper, and due to pituitary and adrenal insufficiency, the patient can present with shock and hypoglycemia. Discussing the features of severe envenomation, these are rapidly extensive local swelling, tender enlargement, local lymph nodes, and early onset of systemic symptoms. In the slide, we can see the local features of snake bite. We can see snake bite, two fang marks here, ranging from swelling to cellulitis. In late stages, there can be necrosis of the digits or toe. Here we can see neurological by neurotoxin, the ptosis. Now let's discuss a very important flowchart by which we can identify the type of snake bite, which type of snake has bitten, by seeing the clinical features. If the patient presents with only neurotoxicity, no other features, only neurotoxicity, and at the site of bite the local swelling is present, then it is cobra bite. And if presents with only neurotoxicity without any local swelling but complaining of symptoms like abdominal pain, vomiting, and has history of lying on floor, it is crate bite. If a patient presents with hemotoxicity, now hemotoxicity can be the only manifestation, which is the case of Russell wiper or saw-scaled wiper. Hemotoxicity along with AKI, then this is case of Russell wiper or humped nose wiper. If the hemotoxicity coexists with AKI, neurotoxicity, and brown colored urine, it is definitely a bite by Russell wiper. If the patient is presenting only with local swelling without any systemic features, then it is a non-venomous bite or dry bite. Now let's begin with the initial management of the patient. We have to follow carry no right approach. The carry means we have to not allow the victim to walk even for any short distance. Just carry him in any form to the hospital. No. There is no role of tourniquet, no electrotherapy, no cutting, and no pressure immobilization. Now let's come to right. R stands for reassure. Reassure the patient that 85% bites are non-poisonous and only 15% bites are poisonous. Therefore, the reassurance of patient is very important so that it does not produce further anxiety. I stands for immobilize. Immobilize the limb as same as we immobilize any fractured limb. We have to lightly wrap the wound. Do not apply any kind of compression. The GH stands for get to the hospital immediately. Since the traditional remedies have no proven benefit, and when the patient reaches to the hospital and gets the ASV less than 7 hours, there is very good outcome. So, the patient should get to the hospital immediately. T stands for tell the doctor any systemic symptoms the patient has felt, like vomiting, dizziness, etc. Now, after reaching to the hospital, we have to look A, B, C, D, E. Airway, breathing, circulation, disability, exposure, and environment control. If the airway is compromised, we have to use head tilt, chin lift, or jaw thrust maneuver. If the consciousness is decreased, then immediately put an ET tube. In breathing, we have to measure the SpO2 of the patient. If SpO2 is low, we have to give supplemental oxygen. If there is respiratory paralysis or any evidence of respiratory paralysis, we have to immediately intubate the patient or start with bag and mask ventilation. For circulation, we have to put two large bore cannula, and if the BP is low, that is the patient has hypotension, we have to give NS or any crystalloid bolus. Avoid RL since we do not know the renal status of the patient. If the patient goes to cardiac arrest, we have to start with CPR. We have to see the disability of CNS, that is the level of consciousness. In exposure and environment control, we have to expose the patient and look for any other injuries if present. And environment control is important to avoid hypothermia and protect the patient from cold. In history taking, we have to ask whether the patient or attendants have seen which type of snake it was, have taken any picture of the snake, whether the bite was dry bite or wet bite. In physical examination, we have to do proper local examination and check if any swelling, bleeding or fang marks are present or not. We have to palpate the tender lymph nodes if present, record the pulse rate and BP. If tachycardia and hypotension present, this will denote hypovolemia. We have to look at skin and mucous membrane of the patient to check whether any petechy, purpura, ecchymosis or conjunctival hemorrhages are present. We have to look for optic fundi and examine the nose to look for any hemorrhage or epistaxis. Per abdominal examination should be done to identify any retroperitoneal hemorrhage. CNS examination can identify any intracranial hemorrhage, and also we can see the neurological features of envenoming, that is ptosis, ophthalmoplegia, facial palsy, bulbar palsy, neck paralysis, respiratory paralysis, or limb muscle weakness. The urine color and output should be seen to identify the type of toxin if it is renal toxic. Now let's have a look what various investigations should be carried out in case of a snake bite. The first and foremost is 20 minute whole blood clotting test. It is considered as the most reliable test of coagulation. This can identify the vasculotoxin at the bedside. It should be carried by the treating physician at the bedside and can identify vasculotoxin or hemotoxin. What is the procedure of doing this test? A few ml of blood is placed in a new dry glass test tube. Avoid syringe or plastic bottles, as these can give false result. After 20 minutes, we look the tube, and the tube is gently tilted. Do not shake the tube. If there is a blood clot present or the blood coagulates, then the test is normal, that is there is no hemotoxin. If the after 20 minutes the blood is still uncoagulable, then it denotes hemotoxicity. So it is a very important test. The specificity of the test is 100%. That is, if the test is positive, then it is definitely a hemotoxin. It should be repeated every 30 minutes till 3 hours of admission. Afterwards, it is done every 1 hour. It is also used to guide the ASV treatment. After giving ASV, the test is repeated after 6 hours. Why after 6 hours? Because the liver takes 6 hours to restore its coagulable levels of clotting factors. If after 6 hours the test becomes normal, that is the blood coagulates, then no further ASV is used. But after 6 hours the test is uncoagulable or the test is positive, then we repeat the dose of ASV. It is done again and again till the test becomes normal. Next, we will send a CBC with peripheral smear. CBC will identify if any septicemia present. Hemoglobin level can tell us about the blood loss. Peripheral smear is very important because it can show us fragmented RBCs due to hemolysis. Therefore, can identify hemotoxicity. Third, a renal function test. Since AKI is very common, especially with Russell Viper and Humped Nose Viper, AKI is due to hypotension or DIC or myoglobinuria, glomerulonephritis or interstitial nephritis. In renal function test, we also have to assess the serum potassium, which can cause life-threatening cardiac arrhythmias, especially due to sea snake bite. Then we do PT-APTT fibrinogen and D-dimer assay for assessing any coagulopathy and assessing the vasculotoxin. Urine dipstick tests are done for blood, hemoglobin, myoglobin and proteins. ABG is done to identify any acid-base disorder. Chest radiography is very important. Chest radiography is important as it can identify pulmonary edema, pulmonary hemorrhage, infarct, pleural effusion or any secondary bronchopneumonia. Electrocardiography can identify arrhythmias, myocardial damage or hyperkalemia. Echocardiography can be planned to see any myocardial dysfunction if present. Now let's come to the mainstay treatment of snake bite, that is anti-snake venom. It is an immunoglobulin. It is a mixture of polypeptides, proteins, which is purified from the serum of horse or sheep, which has been immunized with poisonous snake venom. It can be either monovalent against only one species or polyvalent. In India, only polyvalent anti-snake venom is available, which is against the four most common species, that is cobra, great Russell viper and saw-scaled viper. It is important to note that if the patient has got a bite from hump nose viper, the ASV won't work, and there is very uncertain effectivity against some snake like Sosurex saw-scaled viper, which is exclusively found in Rajasthan. The ASV is available in two forms, either liquid form or lyophilized form. The disadvantage of liquid form is that it requires cold storage. Lyophilized form do not require cold storage, but on the other side, it is very costly. The ASV is given only by IV route, which has to be diluted in NS or dextrose. One vial is diluted in 10 ml of NS or dextrose. Skin sensitivity tests need not to be done. Why these tests are not done in cases of ASV? Because they do not predict any hypersensitivity or late serum reaction. The ASV reactions are mainly complement mediated, not IgE mediated. So, if we are doing any skin sensitivity test, these can sensitize the patient to the antigen and can increase the risk of further reactions. So, skin sensitivity tests are contraindicated, not done. ASV should be used only when the benefits are more than its adverse effects. Since anaphylactic reactions are common and the ASV is also a costly commodity and very scarce, it should be used only when the benefits outweigh adverse effects. It should not be administered locally or intramuscularly. We have to observe the patient for 1 hour after the administering ASV successfully. 0.25 mg of adrenaline is given prophylactically before starting ASV. Now let's see what are the indications of ASV treatment. Since ASV is a very scarce, costly commodity, it should be administered only when there are definite signs of envenomation. Only the unbound and free-flowing venom can be neutralized by ASV in the tissue or bloodstream. In addition, there is a risk of anaphylactic reaction. Therefore, the ASV should be used very cautiously. There are very strict indications of ASV treatment that are systemic envenoming or severe local envenoming. Systemic envenoming can be coagulopathy with positive 20 minutes whole blood clotting time or visible bleeding, neurotoxicity with the features we have discussed like ptosis, ophthalmoplegia, facial palsy, bulbar palsy, neck muscle palsy, etc. Cardiovascular features like hypotension, shock, arrhythmias, abnormal ECG, persistent on severe vomiting, AKI, hemoglobinuria or myoglobinuria. These are the indications of ASV if we get systemic poisoning. Now, coming to severe local envenoming, this is defined by within 48 hours of bite, half of the bitten limb gets swollen. Second, if there are swollen digits following bite. Third, if the swelling is rapidly extensive beyond the wrist or ankle. And there are enlarged tender lymph nodes. So these are the specific indications of ASV treatment, that is systemic envenoming and severe local envenoming, as we have discussed. It is important to note that it is effective only against free circulating venom and not the venom which has already bound. Now let's see how much venom each snake bite injects. Different snakes inject during their bite. The cobra injects 60 mg, crate 20 mg, viper 60 mg, scaled viper 40 mg. The venom which is neutralized by 1 vial of ASV. 1 vial of ASV neutralizes 6 mg of common cobra venom, 4.5 mg of common crate venom, 6 mg Russell viper venom and 4.5 mg saw scaled viper venom. Therefore, the total ASV vials required are maximum for cobra and Russell viper and least for crate. So, it is almost 5 to 10 vials. Now, let's see ASV administration. The total dose, the initial dose starts with 5 to 10 vials and total dose can be 10 to 30 vials. We should start with at least 10 vials, even if the snake is identified to be crate. Which require 5 vials, we should start with at least 10 vials to provide sufficient neutralizing power. What if snake bite occurs in pregnancy and children? We have to give same dose as adults. Snake do not know the difference whether he is biting an adult or a children. Snake injects the same amount of venom into adults and children, therefore same dose of ASV is required. Pregnancy is treated same as that of adults and no other special measure is required. What is the speed or flow rate? All the ASV should be given within 1 hour at a constant speed. How do we know whether we have to repeat the ASV dose or not? If there is persistence or recurrence of incoagulability after 6 hours, we have to repeat ASV, or there are deteriorating or persistent neurotoxic or cardiovascular signs even after 1 to 2 hours. In case of vascular toxicity, we do initial 20 minute whole blood clotting time and test. If it is abnormal, we give initial dose of ASV within 1 hour. Then we wait for 6 hours and repeat the test. If the test comes to be normal, then no further ASV is given. If it is still abnormal, then we repeat 10 vials of ASV again. Some doctors considered giving less dose, like 5 ASV vials, since the unbound venom is declining and ASV is scarce resource. But some literature says that we should repeat the same dose, maximum up to 30 vials can be given. But what if even 30 vials are not able to respond to the hemotoxicity? In some studies, they have given up to 50 vials. But we have to give maximum 30 vials or until the coagulation is restored or the whether the snake species is identified against which polyvalent ASV is ineffective. We have to give the ASV till then. Now let's see how we decide the dose of ASV to be given. When a patient with systemic or local envenoming comes with us, first we will give him 0.25 mg adrenaline subcutaneous for prophylaxis of reactions. Then there can be three settings. If only local envenomation develops within 48 hours, we give 5 to 10 vials of ASV. If even after that there is progressive swelling, then we again repeat 5 to 10 vials. That's it. If the patient with either neurotoxicity plus minus local envenomation or hemotoxicity with or without AKI or hemoglobinuria, myoglobinuria with or without neurotoxicity comes, we have to start with 10 vials of ASV. After giving 10 vials, we have to see whether there is delayed presentation without any worsening, which is most likely in crate bite. No further ASV is given. But after giving 10 vials, we come to know that patient has presented early with worsening or persisting weakness, or there is persistent bleeding, or 20 minutes whole blood clotting time is still abnormal after 6 hours. We have to repeat 10 vials of ASV and so on. Coming to the various reactions caused by anti-snake venom, there are two types of reaction. Either patient can suffer from early reaction or late reaction. Early reaction is a type of allergy or anaphylaxis which is complement mediated. It starts as soon as we start the ASV within 10 minutes. The clinical features are itching, urticaria, bronchospasm or anaphylaxis. How we treat this early reaction? We have to discontinue the ASV. We have to start with adrenaline 1:1000. In adults, the dose is 0.5 mg and children, we have to give 0.01 mg per kg. This dose can be repeated in 5 to 10 minutes. Two doses of adrenaline are usually effective in most cases, but it can be repeated for the third and final occasion. If the BP is low, that is, if the patient has hypotension, or if he is hemodynamically unstable, we give IV fluids. After discontinuing ASV, we have to start it again since we do not have any other choice. Since ASV is the only specific management of snake bite. When the patient is recovered, we start this ASV slowly for 10 to 15 minutes. Keep the patient under observation and resume the normal drip rate afterwards. The second reaction is late reaction, which is serum sickness like reaction. This occurs 1 to 12 days after the giving ASV. This includes symptoms like fever, nausea, vomiting, myalgia, arthralgia, arthritis, can lead to nephritis and neuritis. This can be treated by oral antihistaminics or a course of oral steroids like prednisolone for 5 days. Coming to the supportive treatment, in cases of neurotoxic envenoming caused by common cobra and common crate, the toxin of common cobra is postsynaptic neurotoxin. It binds reversibly with the postsynaptic receptors. There is improvement which starts within 30 minutes to 1 hour of giving ASV, and anticholinesterases like neostigmine are rapidly effective in cobra bite. On the other hand, the common crate has a presynaptic neurotoxin, that is beta bungarotoxin. It binds irreversibly and destroys the presynaptic nerve endings. Early anti-venom treatment might prevent the poisoning, but once the paralysis develops, there is no improvement afterwards. Neostigmine is usually ineffective in this case. How do we give neostigmine? Before giving neostigmine, we pre-treat the patient with 0.6 mg of atropine, then give neostigmine 0.02 mg per kg dose. That is, for 50 kg individual, we will give 1 mg neostigmine. If there is improvement, that is, the ptosis disappears, ventilatory capacity improves, then we start the normal dose of neostigmine, that is 0.5 to 3 mg, which can be repeated every 1 to 3 hours. The maximum dose of neostigmine is 10 mg per 24 hours with atropine at the rate of 0.6 mg per 8 hour infusion. Mechanical ventilation is required for the patients who have undergone respiratory paralysis. Now, treatment of hypotension and shock. The cause of hypotension and shock in snake bite is due to hypovolemia, hemorrhage, myocardial dysfunction, or venom induced vasodilation. How to treat? We have to give a bolus of crystalloids 500 ml to 1 liter. If there is no response, we have to start vasopressors. If the AKI is present in the patient, excess resuscitation can cause pulmonary edema. Therefore, we have to be careful. For bleeding and clotting abnormalities, if the patient continue to bleed even after 3 doses, that is full dose of antivenom, we will estimate PT-APTT. If found efficient, the clotting factors can be replaced if required. For acute kidney injury, the causes are hypotension induced acute tubular necrosis, disseminated intravascular coagulation, myoglobinuria, acute proliferative glomerulonephritis, or acute interstitial nephritis. We have to give cautious fluid challenge diuretics or renal replacement therapy. Now, this is important to note that most patients with acute tubular necrosis, they will recover by few weeks with the help of occasional need of hemodialysis. But if the patient develops cortical necrosis, he will require renal replacement therapy for long term. The hyperkalemia in case of snake bite is the one which requires dialysis more frequently than raised urea or creatinine. The hyperkalemia in cases of snake bite is hypermetabolic type. This is very dangerous and can kill the patient in few hours. The important point to note is the hyperkalemia of snake bite is often unresponsive to calcium gluconate and glucose infusion drip. Therefore, we have to go for hemodialysis. Most commonly, the renal failure is seen with Russell wiper and humped nose wiper. Coming to the last part of the presentation, the treatment of bitten part. First, we will see the wound management. We should not de-roof. Do not de-roof any blister, bulla or blebs. These can be aspirated if required. If there is necrosis or gangrene of the limb, the amputation is the only option left. For bacterial infections, no role of empirical antibiotics. We have seen that there is no role of empirical antibiotics for preventing any secondary bacterial infection. If there is cellulitis or abscess, we can give antibiotics. Third is, if a patient develops compartment syndrome. The patient presents with tensely swollen, painful, cold, pulseless, painful limb. The diagnosis is difficult to make clinically because many local features overlap. We have to avoid facioscapulotomy. And manage the patient conservatively. Most important part is tetanus prophylaxis. Because the snake bite wound is tetanus prone, therefore we should give a shot of TT. But before giving tetanus prophylaxis, we have to rule out the coagulopathy. If the patient is having coagulopathy, the postpone the TT till the ASV therapy and normalization of the coagulopathy. Thank you very much.